Plainfield, Vermont. By now I'd had 49 opportunities to observe what had and hadn't worked when my hosts prepared, or didn't prepare, for my concerts, and here in Vermont I had about a month to set things up for the final concert of the tour in Goddard College's Hay Barn Theater, a benefit for Goddard's community radio station WGDR. I contacted every newspaper, radio station, and community calendar in Vermont, following up relentlessly. I created a poster incorporating a collage of snapshots from the tour and drove around Vermont affixing these posters to the glass doors of backwoods convenience stores and community bulletin boards. I promoted more than I practiced, and in less than 2 weeks was already hearing promos on the radio. Soon there were calendar items, newspaper articles, and a slew of radio interviews, including an hour-long feature on Vermont Public Radio. "So where can we hear you after the tour?" the announcer asked, leaning into the microphone, and I had to think for a second. It was a tough question here at the end of America 88x50, a tour that just sort of happened and that now was just sort of ending, with most of its evidence already packed away into boxes headed for the attic. "You'll probably hear me at your local McDonald's on the other end of the loudspeaker," I said. The stage was framed by strings of little white lights. Ceiling fans spun overhead in the cobweb-laced wooden rafters, and there were about 100 or so chairs set up. In the front of the room, I erected 2 screens to play simultaneous slideshows of the tour, each starting at different points, while the pre-show music played. The hay barn might have been filling up, but to me it seemed empty. With all the publicity, I imagined people lining the walls, but even here at home, and even with the concert proceeds benefiting a beloved community radio station, it still seemed that overall the general public still didn't dare endure a recital of modern American piano music. I felt like I knew everyone in the place. I felt my adrenaline skyrocket, and adrenaline, so I knew from experiences good and bad, could make or break a performance. From the first notes I played, the music seemed to pour out of me with an intensity I couldn't control, like I was being dragged along in a flash flood. I was possessed, and this concert was my exorcism, the exorcism of America 88x50. And like an exorcism, it was messy. I was playing wrong notes and blanking on passages. I was making mistakes I'd never made before in places I'd never had trouble with. I always knew, or rather, feared, that I'd mess some things up in this final concert, a concert that one might have expected, given the practice, I would play with relative ease, but I never expected it to be this bad. It felt like a 360-degree return to how I had played before even my bumbling and unsure Poughkeepsie debut. This was IU. This was high school. This was amateur hour. At intermission, I walked to the balcony behind the audience. They smiled and cheered as I passed. I wanted to cry. I wanted to start the recital over, start the tour over, start everything over. My audience dispersed into the lobby and I sat alone, not really watching anything, just staring ahead, crumbling inside. WGDR's ponytailed station manager, Bert, hopped up onto the balcony risers to meet me. "Time to start again?" I asked. He outstretched his arms for a hug. "Fucking incredible." I hugged him back. "Time to start again?" "Look," he nodded toward the empty seats. "No one's back yet. Your mom set up a nice display of your newspaper clippings in the lobby. People are out there reading them." "Well, maybe in a few minutes then." "Yeah, give people a little time, man." Maybe he saw my worried face, my defeated expression. "It's going great, Adam. Take it easy. Take a breath. You want to go outside? It's tough with no air conditioning in here. I don't know how you do it. I'm all wet just from hugging you." Until then, I hadn't noticed. My clothes were sopping, and beads of sweat were rolling down my temples, down my arms, down to my hands. It got worse. On the last page of the Copland Sonata, that perfect sonic collapse at the end of the piece, that revelatory tolling marked elegiac, which always brought even the most aloof listeners to attention, holding their breath until the final silence of my program, one of the first passages of the piece I'd ever learned and something I never, ever messed up. This was where tonight, my desire to play it perfectly strangled out my concentration completely, and I found myself in a vacuum, guessing and checking, poking at the keyboard like an invalid. I'd forgotten everything. The moment was ruined. The piece was ruined. The concert, the tour, everything, all fucking ruined. The audience stood to their feet and clapped furiously after I made up an ending and leaned back with a defeated sigh. I had learned long ago that only by playing before an audience can a pianist really discover the truth about what they know or don't know about a piece of music, or even an entire program. So, just 6 days short of a year since my first America 88x50 concert, and having just played the final state and sloppiest show of the tour, I faced my truth, bowed, and walked off the stage. The hall emptied, and my family and friends left for an after-party at my house. I tried gathering my things but realized that people had already taken them back to the house for me. My books, my equipment, my car keys. My car keys? I stood frozen. I couldn't believe it. I was stranded at the final venue of America 88x50 while a party celebrating the tour commenced without me. I found Bert walking to his car and called my home on his flip phone. After a few tries, someone finally answered. My keys were on their way. He drove off and left me alone in the parking lot, surrounded by the darkness of the Vermont woods, the moans of the swaying trees, the songs of owls and insects, and memories of the tour. A million memories combining at once into a mass of sound and color I could barely recognize or penetrate. Would America 88x50 become nothing more than an interesting introduction at cocktail parties? A means of convincing strangers and myself that I was actually a concert pianist? I had never believed in closure as much as I believed in getting used to things, and I feared the mediocrity I might get used to now that the tour had ended. Trying to philosophize, I told myself that art is not about finding life's answers, but about creating proof of life in the first place. I told myself that being an artist means having more confidence in one's work than in one's future. I thought of some words by Charles Ives, consonance is relative. I told myself that it's the dissonance that defines a life. The dissonance states that an artist must suffer and savor in order to truly live. But then, all I could really hear was the wind and trees. A custodian from inside appeared. He was tall and grizzled, wearing thick, smudged glasses. "Tonight was the biggest audience I've seen in a long time," he said. "Yeah?" "Oh yeah, people who play way out here don't get nearly half the audience you had." "Why, you think it should have been bigger?" He started to chuckle. "You said your requirement was one person." I shrugged, my gaze down. "Well, I'm one person," he said. "And I never heard anything like what you played tonight."
"The music was..."
"The music is..." "I liked it," he said.
"It was good. You are good.
When'd you start playing?" His words hung there for a moment until I looked up, met his eyes, and smiled, hearing tires in the distance. "I don't know," I said. "Maybe 6 or 7."